Good Sunday morning, everybody. So glad that you're watching today, and I pray that God has blessed you this past week and that you're looking forward to a new week ahead in the Lord. And we want to just bring some quick, exciting news to you. We are coming to you here, obviously, online today, but beginning this coming Wednesday night on December the 16th at 6 p.m., we will be joining back together here in the sanctuary of Calvary Assembly of God, and we will be studying the Word of God together. So we want to invite you to come out and be a part of that. And then the following Sunday on December the 20th, we will be joining together for one service, and that's at 10:30 a.m. And we want to invite you all to come out and be a part of that. We'll be celebrating Christmas together and just worshiping the Lord and celebrating the birth of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. So make plans to be in those services, and we are planning on being back on track and worshiping the Lord together in the coming services. So we're so thankful for that, and we want to get right into the Word today. Speaking of Christmas, we began last Sunday talking about the Christmas story, and we're talking about two individuals last Sunday, Zechariah and Mary, who were both charged with the word from the angel of the Lord that said, "Fear not." They were both faced with some unique situations and had to respond in either faith or in fear. And so obviously Mary responded in faith, but Zechariah had some fear and some concern. And because of that, the Lord had allowed him to be silenced so that he could not bring doubt and unbelief into the lives of those who needed to hear the voice of the Lord. And so again, we fear not because we don't want our voice to be silent. We want to speak forth faith. We don't want our faith to be silenced. We want to announce our faith and broadcast our faith. Mary, on the other hand, knew that the Lord was in control and was taking care of her situation as well, and he promised to her that nothing shall be impossible to the Lord. And so today I want to talk to you about Joseph, and we'll be looking at the book of Matthew chapter number 18. And chapter number 1, verse number 18, and you can follow along if you would like to. I'm going to read it from the New Living Translation this morning, and here's what the Word of God says. It says, "This is how Jesus, the Messiah, was born. His mother, Mary, was engaged to be married to Joseph, but before the marriage took place, while she was still a virgin, she became pregnant through the power of the Holy Spirit. Joseph, to whom she was engaged, was a righteous man and did not want to disgrace her publicly, so he decided to break the engagement quietly. So, as he considered this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, 'Joseph, son of David, fear not, or do not be afraid to take Mary as your wife, for the child within her was conceived by the Holy Spirit. And she will have a son, and you are to name him Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins.'" You've got to see this, that Joseph and Mary, both all of these participants here in what we term as the Christmas story, are just simply human beings walking planet Earth, breathing the oxygen like you and I do on a daily basis. We are here on this earth just as they were, yet they were faced with some unique situations and circumstances that they had to figure out how to respond to. And so when you're facing earthly situations, you've got to know that the Lord wants us to have heavenly insight and a heavenly revelation, or looking at it from heaven's point of view. And so here's Joseph, who we see going through an occurrence that is difficult to comprehend and therefore difficult to properly respond to. He wasn't sure exactly how to respond to this unique situation that he was facing. And so he's first of all facing the knowledge that the young lady he is about to marry is now expecting a child, and he knows that it's not his. And so he is obviously concerned there, And so with that that concern that he has, his mind is thinking. He's already, his wheels are turning on what to do. And then you've got to look at the same time, you have Mary over here who knows that the Lord had spoken to her, and who knows the Holy Spirit has done the work of conception here in this situation. And so she's facing this, knowing that, but yet facing the response of people and what people are going to say to her. They, you know, that she's thinking they're going to accuse her of being promiscuous, and you know she's going to have to face some embarrassment that she's concerned about there, because people are going to talk and slander her and gossip, and it's such a painful thing when people are spreading rumors about you and talking about you behind your back. And so Mary was facing that situation here in her circumstance. And so when faced with earthly circumstances, our only normal response and reaction would be to respond by natural means. If you're facing a natural problem, you want to face things naturally. But we have a supernatural God, and this will unfold even more here in this story as we read about it. But some of the most distressing times that we go through and experiences that we face are those things that we cannot necessarily we can't explain them. Why am I going through what I'm going through? Why is life going the way it is? Or why did that loved one get taken away at such an early age? Or why did I lose my job? Or why is my finances falling apart? Why is my marriage falling apart? Why am I going through what I'm going through? I try to do everything right, but yet here I am in a situation where I can't explain why it has turned out this way. So life is full of the question why. It's constantly that we have those moments when we are crying out to the Lord, why are we facing what we're facing? We tried to do what we knew to do, but yet here we are in a circumstance that we can explain. And so here Mary was in that type of situation. Uncertainties in life are enough to cause anyone to fear. Anytime we are facing uncertain situations, we have just the tendency to allow fear to arise. But one thing that we can be certain of, and one person that we can be certain of, is the God of heaven, in whom James said there is no variableness, neither shadow of turning. He is a stable anchor in our uncertainty, in our storms. And so we see Joseph here facing a dilemma, whether to follow after fear or whether to trust the word of God through the angel of the Lord. And so here he is in this dilemma. There is no fear when we realize that God's got a plan in action that's working in our life. And so that's what the angel's job was to do, to come to Joseph and to assure Joseph that God was leading him through this circumstance, and that God was going to fulfill his purpose in all of this. It reminds me of what Paul said in Romans, that we know that all things work together for good to them that love God and are called according to his purpose. So here we see this dilemma that Joseph is in, but now he's facing this word from God that says God is in control. God is going to work it out for our good. And so I want to remind you of a quote that I told you last week from the late evangelist and pastor David Wilkerson, who said, any promise of God is simply a revelation of his will. So what does that mean to us? It means that the key to surviving uncertain times is to latch on to something that is stable. The old song that we sang, I'm standing on the promises of God. Why? Because the promises of God are stable, they're unshakable, and in uncertain times, you and I have to have a solid foundation on which to stand, and that is on the promises of the Lord Jesus Christ. And the only thing that is stable according to the Word of God in this life is the Word of God. And so consider what Matthew said in Matthew 24:35. He says, heaven and earth shall pass away, but my words will never pass away. They are certain in uncertainty. They are strong in weak times. They are stable in unstable situations. And so when we have a faith in the knowledge that God has a plan for our life, that erases the fear and the confusion of uncertain times that may come against us. God's plan for us supersedes the uncertainties that arise along the way. So the angel came to Joseph and said, "Fear not, Joseph. God has this worked out. God is in control. God is working for your good. Fear not, because God has a plan for your life." And church, I just want to tell you, fear not, because God knows what He's doing in your situation. You don't have to fear. You don't have to be overcome with concern and care. You trust in the Lord, because God has it under control. Fear not, because God has a plan for your life. And the third group of people that, or excuse me, the last group of people that I want to talk about, the fourth group, we talked about Mary and Zechariah and Joseph, and now I want to talk about the shepherds. In the Gospel of Luke, chapter number 2, verse number 8, we see the story of the shepherds. And I'll just pick up about verse 8 here, and you can follow along. It says, "And there were in the same country shepherds abiding in the field, keeping watch over their flock by night. And lo, the angel of the Lord came upon them, and the glory of the Lord shone round about them, and they were sore afraid. And the angel said unto them," again, "fear not, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people." So the glory of the Lord is appearing before these angels, or excuse me, before these shepherds. The glory of God is showing Himself. It says, "The glory of the Lord shone round about those angels that were standing before the shepherds." And when the glory of the Lord appears, it exposes the weakness and the fear and the anxieties of humanity. And so God's glory is being revealed here. And when God's glory is revealed, the fear of the audience will rise to the surface. Such was the case with the shepherds. We see their fear. They were in great trembling and great worry, and the Bible says here they were sore afraid. They were so concerned about what they were witnessing. And this event confirms what Paul said in 1 Corinthians 1:29. "No flesh shall glory in the presence of God." No flesh shall rise up in the presence of God. Only the glory, when the glory of God shows up, flesh diminishes. You remember what John the Baptist said, "He must increase, His glory must increase, and I must decrease." And so we see this happening here in real time with the shepherds. As the glory of the Lord appeared, these men cowered down in fear. These were brave men. These were men who would stay out overnight and fight for their sheep and protect their sheep and guard against lions and whatever would come their way. They weren't just a bunch of wimps out somewhere. They were bold and brave men. But yet, when the glory of the Lord shows up, every man, no matter who it is, every woman, no matter who it is, will bow and fall in the presence of Almighty God. And so here we see this. If the shepherds would have chosen to reject the good tidings that the angel brought them, then it would have resulted in a continual life of fear within the shepherds. We would have seen that fear remain. But we see something happening as the angel proclaimed good tidings. The Bible says that these shepherds began to have a change of attitude in this situation, and so. So likewise, when mankind is confronted with the good news of the gospel of Christ, we too have to choose whether we are either going to, one, reject it and continue on the path that leads to fear and destruction in our life, or we accept the good news and experience the peace and the power of God that accompanies it. The sad truth is that many throughout the earth and throughout history has chosen to reject Jesus Christ. and that he is the Messiah that was come to the earth, and they choose rather to continue on their own path of temporary pleasure and fear and destruction. And I want to tell you, if you're watching today and listening today and you have chosen your own path, you need to stop that path and turn to follow Jesus Christ, because this life only has temporary pleasure, but the life that you'll follow in him, you'll find eternal pleasure, and that's so much greater. And so you've got a witness here, as the shepherds did, as they began to accept this knowledge of Jesus and this good tidings of great joy. The scripture says those who believe the good tidings of great joy of Jesus Christ and accepted him as their Savior and Lord now walk in a boldness and in an assurance that is free of fear, that just as Jesus came as a babe in a manger 2,000 years ago, now we who are following him are looking for his second coming, when he comes back as King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And so there is no fear in that. There is a wonderful anticipation in that. There is a joy in the midst of an unstable and uncertain world. There is a joy in the midst of uncertain times, that we are looking to the one who is coming back soon to redeem us unto himself. And that is such a blessing to know that Jesus Christ is coming back, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. So what did the shepherds have to do? Just like you and I have to do. We have to choose an encounter over an escape. The shepherds could have chosen to escape, to run and hide, and to get away in fear, but they did not reject this message as something that was not relevant to their situation, nor did they put it off and choose to wait until a more opportune time. They immediately responded to the good tidings of great joy that came to them. If you look on down in verse 15, it says they chose to go and see this thing which the Lord had made known unto them. Verse 16 says they went with haste to experience it for themselves. Verse 17 says that they made known abroad what they had heard and seen. And then finally, in verse 20, it says they glorified and praised God, probably for the rest of their lives. They glorified and praised God for what they had seen and heard. So they chose to go. Then when they got on the path, they went with haste. And once they experienced the presence of God in the Lord Jesus Christ, they made known abroad what they had seen, and they lived lives from then on glorifying and praising God. So what did the angel tell the shepherds to do? Fear not, because you have good news to deliver. Church, I want to tell you, there you can look around at the fearful and the uncertain situations that our world is facing right now, and you look around at the news and you listen to what is being reported over the airways, and all the things that we are hearing, the voices of conversations that we are having with people where they're fearful and they're concerned. I want you to understand that the word of the Lord to you and me today is to fear not, because we have good news to bring. We have an answer to bring. We are not part of the earth's problems. We are the ones with the answer, and we are able to point people on the right path. So you have the good news of the Lord Jesus Christ to proclaim. So you speak with boldness. Don't fear. Don't cower now. Rise up with boldness and proclaim the word of God. Can I close with this? I want to just remind you of each of these four individuals. When they were faced with the opportunity to fear, what did the Lord do? He sent his word to speak directly into their lives, and his word brought an assurance and a confidence and a boldness. So what I just want to remind you of, when you start to get overcome with fear and you start to have that fear rising up in your life, you get in this word, you get in the scriptures, and you let the word of God speak to you and bring comfort and boldness to you. Now, let me close with this one scripture that I think is so powerful. It speaks of the psalmist in Psalms 56. And I'll just read a couple of verses here, three or four verses here, just so you can see this. Verse 1, it says, Lord, have mercy on me, All day long, the enemy troops press in. So many are proud to fight against me. How they long to conquer me. But when I am afraid, he didn't say, I'm not afraid. He says, when I am afraid, I will put my confidence in you. Yes, I will trust in the promises of God. And since I am trusting him, what can mere man do to me? What can the things of this world do to me when I trust in God? On down in verse 9, he says it like this. He says, the very day I call for help, the tide of battle turns. My enemies flee. This one thing I know, God is for me. He goes on and says, I am trusting God. Oh, praise his promises. I am not afraid of anything mere man can do to me. Praise his promises. Yes, praise his promises. I will surely do what the Lord, what I promise, Lord, and I will thank you for your help. What is he saying here? He says, in those moments when I am afraid, I'm going to trust in the promises of God. I'm going to look to the word of God that tells me to fear not in this crazy world and crazy life that we're living in. I have nothing to fear because God is on my side. Amen. And if you are serving Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, you have nothing to fear as well. And I want to just encourage you, if you don't know Jesus as your Lord and Savior today, let this Christmas season, let today be the day of salvation for you. Accept him as your Savior. Repent of your sins and let him cleanse you and wash you completely. Would you let me pray with you before I go today? And let's just pray together right where you are. Let's just pray together. Father, in the name of Jesus, you know everyone that is watching this video, whether it is on this Sunday morning or it's sometime in the future. Lord, the wonders of technology, we can see recordings maybe years down the road. But Lord, whenever the hearer is listening to this word right now, I pray that you would just reach down to their heart, Lord, and draw them to you. I ask you, Lord, to forgive them of their sins, to cleanse them of every ungodly thing and everything that has gone against your will. Lord, I pray as they confess their sins to you that you would forgive them and cleanse them and receive them unto yourself. Lord, I thank you for the mercy and the grace of Jesus Christ that was sent as a babe in a manger and lived a sinless life, died on a cruel cross, but rose again on the third day, ascended to heaven, and is one day coming back to receive us all back unto himself. I pray, Lord God, that you would just help us to follow that path of Jesus that Jesus has laid out for us. And Lord Jesus Christ, give us strength and help and ability in uncertain times. Take away our fear. Cast down every fear and every imagination that would exalt itself against our knowledge of Jesus Christ. And give us peace during this time of trouble. Lord, we thank you and praise you for it in the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. If you prayed with me today and if you asked Jesus into your heart, I want to encourage you to text the word journey to that number on the screen and let it be a blessing to you. There's some resources that will help you following the Lord, and it'll just be a great encouragement to you. Thank you so much for watching. We look forward to seeing you very soon. Be blessed and let the Lord just stir your heart today in Jesus' name. Amen. See you next time.